So here in Psalm 57, I want to suggest to you that this psalm is kind of broken up into two sections. Maybe turn with me and you can see them. Look with me at verse 5. It says, "Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over the earth." And then if you turn the page, verse 11, listen to this. It says, "Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth." It's the same words, right? I love it when the Bible does this for us. It just breaks it down for us, okay? And so we're going to have kind of two points, and the first point is going to be much longer than the second point. But here's what I want to do. I want us to look at this first little section and see this, that we have a need for salvation. And then the second section, which is actually following on this, is sort of a need for song, okay? A need for salvation, a need for song. So first, a need for salvation. Well, if you look at this, the first line of verse 1 is this. "Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me." Now, what you might immediately want to ask is, why is he crying out for mercy? Now, we just sang a long song, Psalm 51, on crying out for mercy for our sin, the way that we've acted in rebellion against God. And that's certainly something that has we cry out for a lot, and the Psalms invite us to do that, and the Bible invites us to do that. But the first title part of our psalm actually gives us a clue into why he's crying out for mercy. It says two things that I want you to see. One, it says that it was to be sung to the tune, "Do Not Destroy," which I am totally convinced is like a heavy metal screamo tune, right? Like, "Do not destroy," that kind of thing. And then it's actually said to be a miktam of David. We actually don't know what that word means, a miktam. There's a lot of little words like that. In fact, like the word selah that you sometimes see in the Psalms, we don't totally know what that means. We think it means pause or peace, but that's actually why it's not translated. We don't translate it because we're not totally convinced of what it means. Miktam is the same thing. We actually don't totally know what miktam means, but it's a genre, and it's probably the screamo genre, right? But the other thing that we learn is that David is in a cave because he's been fleeing from Saul. Okay. What we have is David is crying out for mercy because he is actually worried about possibly being destroyed, right? Do not destroy. He's crying out from a place of refuge, the cave, and he's crying out because somebody's after him, King Saul. Now, here's what I want to suggest to you, and I want to do it this way. I want to suggest to you that part of what he's crying out for mercy from is actually other people. And then I want you to consider this, and this is we're going to get to this eventually, but I want us to consider that he's also crying out for this need for mercy and salvation from even the places where he takes refuge. I hope you'll understand what I mean by that in a little bit. Okay, first, salvation from others. Here's what I think is tempting when you come to the Bible. I think it's tempting when you come to the Bible to approach it and think that all it has to do with is what's in your heart or within your soul or within your head, right, your mind. And there's good reasons for why we kind of approach the Bible like this. One is the Bible is a religious text. And we know that religion has to do with your soul and your heart and what's going on in the unseen. The other thing is that we're told, the world that we live in at large tells you your religion is private. It's just for you, inside of your closet. Maybe it's on Sunday mornings, but once you leave that door, don't take it with you into public places at least. Don't invite it into your work, or certainly don't let it influence your politics or your policy or any of that kind of thing. Religion is just for you and sort of your own private place. That could not be further from the case from what the Bible teaches, actually. The Bible opens up from the very beginning and says, God made all things. It begins the idea of religion as saying it's all creation. All of it exists for him, and it's made by him, and it's declared good for him, and all of it's to be offered up to him. Everything that you do is offered up to God. So it kind of pushes against that from the beginning. But also what we see is that actually rebellion against God, too, sin, is a very physical thing, right? What we're told is that Adam and Eve, these first parents in the garden, actually took something. That was their rebellion. It wasn't just a rebellion in the heart. It was actually a physical rebellion that was taking place. It's a physical thing that's going on. Okay, so here's what I'm suggesting to you. We shouldn't just think that mercy is only for the sort of the inner parts of the hearts. That's true. That's part of it. But there's also this thing that we need salvation from the physical world, and sometimes that exists as other people. David is fleeing from Saul. Salvation needs to happen sometimes just from other people specifically, okay? Look with me down at verse 3, okay? Verse 3, he will send from the heaven and save me. He will put to shame him who tramples on me. Him who tramples on me. So there's a specific enemy in view here. But we also get in this psalm that it's not just a specific enemy, but there's also this idea that there's generally other people, right? Physical, in the flesh people that he needs saving from. Verse 4, look at this. My soul is in the midst of lions. I lie down amid fiery beasts. Kids, you guys know how to read. How do you distinguish between a singular and a plural? One thing and two things in words. Normally an S, right? You put an S at the end of a word. It's like pastor or pastors, right? Well, here it's not. He's not just talking about one person. He's like a whole group of people, okay? It says, the children of man, children, whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. Okay, so David's fleeing from Saul, but it seems also that there's whole groups of people that are after him. Now I want you to think about this with me. Do you all remember where we left off last summer in the Psalms? Come on, in some ways this is an easy, yes, 56. Okay, on some level that's actually a really easy answer. On another level, I understand that that's like a whole long time ago and you don't remember. It's fine. But here's what was happening last summer in the Psalms, is that again and again and again, David was saying, Lord, meet me in my distress. Lord, there's somebody coming after me. I need you to show up. This is a scary situation. So let me remind you a little bit. Psalm 52 was written in response to Doeg the Edomite. You might maybe remember Doeg the Edomite. That dude was bad. He betrayed David when David was with Ahimelech, the priest, and he went and told Saul about it. And then Doeg led the people to go slaughter Ahimelech and 84 priests along with their families. Bad dude. Okay. Maybe you remember how Psalm 54 told us about the betrayal of the Ziphites. I know there's lots of names like that in the Bible. It's kind of hard to remember all of them. But part of what you're supposed to be thinking about there is that those were the people around actually David. David should have found protection from them, and he didn't. He was actually betrayed. A whole group of people. Doeg, one guy who's kind of leading a revolt against David and killing other people, he's leading it. But now there's a whole group of people. Maybe you remember, actually, in Psalm 56, maybe you'll remember this as I mention this, Psalm 56 is the psalm where David recounts the story how he goes to the town of Gath, which is in Philistia, which would have made a lot of sense for him to go into an enemy territory, so Saul went follow him there. But they recognize him when he's there, and what does he do? He acts like he's gone mad, and he escapes. He's really creative in how he escapes. He acts like he's gone mad. Here's what I'm saying, is that just here in the 50s of the Psalms, what you have is this individuals who are enemies, whole groups of people who are enemies, the Ziphites and the Philistines. You have, of course, Saul, and you have Doeg. Maybe you actually remember this, that in Psalm 56, one of the things that it says is, what can flesh do to me? I mean, if God's for me, what can other people do to me? And we had thought about how pandemics and lockdowns and massive increases in depression, all these sorts of things make us go, man, the flesh can do a lot. And David says, you know what? With the Lord, you are still safe. you're still safe. His mercy is for you. His salvation is for you. Okay, so here's what I'm trying to point out, is that here in this passage, at least, there's this dynamic of seeking salvation from a specific individual and also from groups of people. And that seems kind of basic. But I want you to think about this, okay? Think about the singular person that David is seeking salvation from, Saul. Many of you know this. Saul was actually anointed by God, right, by Samuel, to be the king. He was put in that place of power to exercise that power for the good of those who were under him. David should have found refuge under Saul and his power. Instead, he's fleeing from him. Saul should have had David's best interest in mind. And the fact is that that's actually one of the great enemies that so many people experience in the world. Somebody who should have actually had your best interest in mind and abuses that power. Many people can recount about how the most scarring thing is there in their life was how a teacher spoke to them, or how a parent abused them, how they demeaned them with their words. So many people know how absolutely scarring it is to have a father, particularly, and I think that's partly why the instructions for fathers in the New Testament are don't provoke your children to anger, to wrath, is because the father says, you know what, kid? The Bible tells you to honor and obey me. And I'm going to do anything I can to make sure you do it. And you know how utterly crushing that can be. One person in power that's been put there properly can absolutely actually be your worst enemy. Some of you know how often this takes place in the context of a boss. You show up, you put your time in, and yet nothing is ever right. So many people can speak to the dynamics of pastors who abuse their authority, their place, and they crush others, or they spiritually abuse others, or they sexually abuse others. It's doubtful that many people have been like Saul to you. They've been actually out to kill you and sought where you were hiding in the cave. But it's actually very likely that most of us have actually experienced somebody who's over us, who's abused that authority, and they have been enemies of God and enemies of you. And this psalm is telling you, you can say, Lord, they're like lions. They're out to get me. Save me from this physical enemy. But it's also groups of people, and I think this is actually really helpful too, because it's true that sin is something that's inside of us and oftentimes works itself out in ways that are harmful to others. But sin is not just always personal, but it also can be systemic, and it can be social, and there can be sins that are sins that whole groups of people grab onto. They can be collective. Sins can have systemic effects. Systems or groups of people can be used together to harm an individual or harm another whole group of people. That's something that's true in the Bible. We all know right now that Putin is largely leading the war against Ukraine, but it's not just Putin, and everybody knows that. There's all kinds of other people involved, right? This week, I spent some time, a little while, watching this new documentary on Prime Video called Shiny Happy People. I don't know if any of y'all have seen this. Many of you probably should see it. But it's sort of telling some of the story of the Duggar family, that huge family that had like 19 kids that was on TLC quite a few years back. Many of you know that their oldest, Josh Duggar, is in prison and was so because of promulgating content, online content that he shouldn't have had and all of that. But the story is not just about Josh or about his father, Jim Bob, or about his mother, or about this huge family. It seems like the big thing that it's about is the Institute for Biblical Life Principles. I mean, it has the word Bible in it. It's this huge organization, largely, of course, run by Bill Gothard. It's a whole system, And it's a whole system that has so often built abusive situations, time and time and time again. What I'm suggesting to you is this passage is saying that enemies can be individuals and they can be whole groups of people. And the Bible itself is saying, lay this before the Lord and ask him to save. Ask him to show up. Ask him to save. Ask him to do something about it. I need salvation, Lord, from this authority who's abusing it. I need salvation, Lord, from this whole group of Christians. Okay, let me shift a little bit. What I'm suggesting to you is that part of the thing that's saying, be merciful to me, save me, is from actually just really physical people, individuals and groups. I think that's a big part of what's been being said here. But I also think there's this really little detail here that we would lose something if we skimmed over it. So verse 1, let me read it again for you. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me. For in you my soul takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge till the storms of destruction pass by. Here's the thing. What we learned from that title is that David is in the cave. Little FYI, actually, in Hebrew, the title is always the first verse, so that would be verse 2 in the Hebrew. But the cave, is in the midst of actually a whole series of limestone caves. In fact, there is a national park in Israel now that is called the Park of Adullam. And you know how big it is? It's 12,000 acres. It's a huge park. And there's hiking trails and biking trails, and there's 4 different archaeological sites. But the thing you need to understand is that the Cave of Adullam wasn't just some tiny, tiny cave. There were probably multiple caves in the region of Adullam, which is actually a place that we first learn about all the way back in Genesis 38. But it's talking specifically about the cave. There would have been a specific one that people would have known that maybe people would have gone to find refuge. It was a special cave that was maybe deeper down into this solid rock that you could hide. Imagine, though, that like this would have been something that people would have known about. Maybe they would have even dug it out. Limestone caves all around the world are actually oftentimes dug out for various purposes. Some of you maybe have seen pictures of the Ear of Dionysius on Sicily. It's an enormous 70 feet high dug-out cave into the limestone. We're not really sure why it was dug out, but it keeps going back into this limestone a long ways. Have any of you been to Mammoth Caves in Kentucky? Maybe a couple of you have been to Mammoth Caves in Kentucky. That is the largest limestone cave in the world, and people say that's 400 miles of caves in Mammoth Caves. Okay, so this is a limestone cave in Israel, and it would have been a place, the cave would have been a place where people knew they could go hide. What I'm suggesting to you is that he is in the place of refuge, right? And actually, what we find out is that God did meet him there, and he brought other people to him, his family and his mighty men. They came to meet him there at the Cave of Adullam. But what he ultimately says is, this is not my refuge. You're my refuge. He says, for in you my soul takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge. Just after he'd mentioned the cave. To quote this well-known commentator, Derek Kidner, he says this, you see, solid rock even by itself can be a trap as well as a stronghold. Even the places that we seek refuge can be traps as well as strongholds. Let me give you an example, something I've mentioned at least once before to you. A friend of mine was in my Bible study as a freshman in college at Western Washington University, and we also played on some intramural soccer teams together. He was really good at soccer, and a few years after I graduated, I learned that he, in a soccer game, had injured his knee really badly. He had actually married another one of my good friends, but he had injured his knee, and he actually needed surgery, and he got some pain medication after this surgery for the sake of his knee. Well, you know what happened. This place that he went for refuge in the midst of that pain actually became a deep addiction. And what happened is that his wife eventually found stacks of credit card statements that he had maxed out, new credit cards that he had opened up, just tons and tons of debt so that he could get more pain medications. The very thing he went to for refuge in the midst of that pain, saying, "Be merciful to me and save me from this," became the actual thing that led to their own divorce the next year. What I'm suggesting to you is any other refuge, even possibly good places of refuge, like the cave, can actually be to your detriment. God alone is your salvation. Think about this. We all know that some of us, and probably all of us at times, take refuge in things like substances and food and exercise. Let's just exercise enough to not think about something. Or let me just read a book. Good things can become places where we actually run to instead of the Lord. And he's saying no other place will be your salvation. In you alone is my refuge. You know this. Y'all, the devil never creates in the Bible. You cannot find the devil creating. You can find him distorting good things. And a lot of times you might run to a good thing to find your refuge from this situation where something's happening. You're like, I need to get away from that. And you run to this good thing, and then that good thing, you think it's just going to feed you and it's going to save you, and it becomes your very destruction. And I think this is why, actually, we have this refrain in verse 5 and then again in verse 11. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Because he's saying, let me see that you're actually above all of these things. Let me see that you're above these people that are running after me, these individuals and these groups, and even the places where I'm going for refuge. Let me see that you're more weighty, you're more glorious than all these other things, that your salvation can actually be for me, that you exist outside of the realm of this place. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let me look to you alone for salvation and show yourself to be the one who can show up and save. Be my solid rock, because even the solid rock, as Kidner said, can be a trap as well as a stronghold, the solid rock that we look to in this life.